Guys, in this last exercise for lecture number 2, we will analyze loads and shunts in Power Factory. So the key point for the load is to assess how important is the voltage dependency in both active and reactive power consumption. So let's go to Power Factory. I already had a copy of the grid. I used the same configuration that was used in the previous example. So we have the complete line model, we have the complete transformer model, and the generator is controlling the voltage locally. So let's have a look at the load right now. As in all other elements, in the basic data you get prompt information such as name, type, and terminal. And under the load flow, you get the necessary input for active and reactive power consumption. As always, we will be assuming balanced loads. Let's have a look at the type. So under the type, we can see the technology. So whether the load is a three phase, single phase, if it is star or delta connected, AC or DC. And then under the load flow tab, you can find the voltage dependency factor for active and reactive power. So whether the load should be 100% with no dependency on the voltage, or 100% in this case with a linear dependency on the voltage, or 100% with a quadratic dependency on the voltage. And of course the same applies for the reactive power. So let's see what's gonna happen now if we change parameter and we maintain this quadratic dependency. So as expected, we can see that the load, despite being dispatched 100 megawatt, will be consuming 98.3, because that's 100 megawatt times the square of the per unit voltage value, which right now is 99.1%. Let's see also what's going to happen in the moment we add some reactive power consumption as well. You see now that we have a quadratic dependency for the active power, which pulled down to 72.4 megawatt, while the reactive power consumption is without any voltage dependency, so it's 100 megawatt. You can also appreciate how the voltage got quite low, 85%. And also how important actually is to correctly model the reactive voltage, the reactive power dependency on the voltage. Because for instance, if actually this load has a quadratic dependency also on the reactive power, then we will experience a lower consumption in case of lower voltage values, which of course will result in a higher voltage compared to before. The same will apply also if we switch to capacitive consumption or capacitive production for the reactive power. As always, remember that Power Factory is following the following convention. So for loads, it will be using the load convention. So positive active power implies consumption, while positive reactive power implies inductive behavior. And of course, negative reactive power is a capacitive behavior. It's actually the other way around for generators when we are dispatching this active and reactive power set point. So also in this case, we can see how critical is this voltage dependency, because right now the voltage, because of the high amount of capacitive power, got quite large. And this impact on the current active and reactive power consumption. So that's about the loads. Now, we would like also to spend a few words also on the shunts. Why? Because in the end, if we have this large amount of capacitive power or inductive power, it's not really wise to let them all this reactive power flow through this long line, which is 100 kilometers, but it could be actually more convenient to set a shunt. So let's say that we are gonna connect one shunt here right now. So we will connect inductive shunt, of course, because we want to compensate for the load, for the capacitive load. So let's say that we want to design a shunt that has a 10 megavar per step, and actually it has 10 steps. So it can be adjusted. And then we can see that we can either dispatch it manually, or we can dispatch it with the shunt controller. As you can see, if we just make a dispatch, a manual dispatch, we will experience, of course, a certain amount of provision of the reactive power. It also makes sense that despite we dispatched 50 megavar, then of course the actual consumption or generation of reactive power will depend on the voltage value, because we are assuming just a, let's say, conventional reactor, so there is no power electronic behind. We would like maybe also to see in a bit smarter way also to have implemented a shunt controller, so that we can actually dispatch the capacitor or the shunt in a proper way. So we can define a shunt controller, we can specify which node we would like to control, and then we run the load flow and we see that nothing happened. And that's why, because we need to also select this flag and let Power Factory adjust the shunt. And so in this case we can see that, as one would expect, the shunt controller is gonna to deploy the whole reserve to fully compensate for the capacitive load in the load, so that we hit the target voltage, which is 1 per unit. The same, of course, can be said in the other way around. So instead of having a shunt made of inductors, we can have a shunt made of capacitor. The principle is exactly the same. So we can specify again 10 steps, again a shunt controller, we run the load flow, and then we see exactly the same result, just the other way around. Also in this case, if we disable the shunt adjustment, then we will see the result, which is the manual dispatch of the capacitors. You will actually appreciate how these shunt capacitors are actually could be quite dangerous, because they are simple capacitor, their contribution tend to decrease when the voltage gets lower. And of course it decreases with a quadratic dependency. And that's exactly the time when you need most of the support. So it's an aspect that really needs to be carefully assessed, because otherwise you will be short of a reactive capacitive supply exactly in the moment when you need it. So proper sizing and management of this capacitor is necessary. And that's pretty much covering all the components that we have in our grid.